Doc, I'm Yorgos Rizopoulos. I'm professor of economics here in this university, Paris Diderot University. And let's say that my research fields concern generally institutional and organizational dynamics, to simplify. New organizational models. And I work on multinational firms almost during the beginning of my career as a researcher, but let's say with a different intensity concerning the different periods. Some for several years I don't do anything and I come back. And now I work more specifically on what we call, and we'll discuss about that today, the political strategies of multinational corporations. And so, well, I'll try to give you some general elements based on a paper that you have, I think, concerning some questions that we can make about that. So, if you don't mind, I prefer when I present in English, I prefer to sit. It's not my habit, but I prefer walking around. But in English, it's better to be close to my notes. It's less dynamic, but more clear. You know? So, okay. So the my presentation today this little apparatus, is based on, let's say, three research work with different statuses. One published paper that you have, I think, published in the Journal of World Business some years ago. Another paper which is a chapter of a collective book concerning patterns of multinationals and state interactions in international business. And third paper, which is an achieved one. In the last year, 3 years, I tried to finish this paper, but different reasons make that it is not finished yet. It was just a communication indeed concerning the corruption practices of multinational enterprises in the host countries. But I give you some elements about that if we have enough time. So the main points of my presentation concern some words about firms' political strategies in general, because I think that it's important to understand what we are talking about. And I will continue with, let's say, an historical overview, very brief historical overview of theories and perceptions concerning multinationals and state relations. And the third point, more precisely, will be to present policy networks, which is a concept which stems from political sciences as an institutional framework of these interactions between multinationals and governments. Some words about the futures of these political networks, taxonomy, and to arrive to the impact of the multinationals' structural position inside these policies networks in order to evaluate political leverage in the home country and also formulate some propositions concerning the strategic approach towards host countries. Well, there is a big question about corruption, which is generally not included in political strategies for reasons that we can understand, but which makes problem. And as I said, if we have enough time, I will give you some elements about the problems concerning corruption practices, indeed. So, what we are talking about when we talk about political strategies, firms' political strategies? It's quite interesting to notice that the mainstream paradigm of organization economics, especially transaction cost theory and agency theory, are silent about what we can call the no market phenomena. Even though this no market phenomena also affects efficiency, and greatly affects efficiency, which is supposed to be the main concern of this paradigm. More surprisingly, I think, alternative approaches such as resource-based evolutionary theories, which point out the distinctive competencies of firms, resources, capabilities, do not consider political competencies. In general, political factors in economics, in economic especially, in organizational analysis, act at the best as constraints. Political markets, in other words, all the means acquired and used to gain rents, are not considered as making part of firms' strategic objectives. Well, this is the point. What we are talking about, well, a political strategy aims to modify well, let's say at the beginning that the literature on firms' political strategies integrates political behavior as a crucial complement of economic behavior. And consider that generally political strategies reinforce competitive strategies, means market strategies, and may even predominate over strictly economic means. That means that sometimes, quite usually, political markets became more important than economic markets. So a firm's political strategy aims to modify its set of opportunities or the set of opportunities of its competitors. How? By creating political advantages. Political advantage in a very broad sense of the term, I'll explain a little bit more. Therefore, political strategies concern all the actions engaged with the intention of influencing and orienting public policies, stricto sensu. But in a broad sense, we can define as political strategies all activities that develop a power of influence to obtain an advantage and overcome resistance of other actors in situations characterized by the confrontation of divergent interests. As such, political strategies are focused on actors located in what we can call the no-market environment of the firm, governments, interest groups, the intelligentsia, public opinion, etc. And they are focused also on a variety of actions, such as negotiation, formal or informal procedures of negotiation, cooperation, compliance, legitimation strategies, and so on. Indeed, different categories of political strategies are identified in the literature. You have some references for if somebody of you wants to have some more precise bibliographic references, I am ready to give these references. In different categories of political strategies are identified in the literature. At first, all that is financial incentives, which, let's say, in the European institutional environment, it's a little bit complicated to evaluate because sometimes in France, for example, can be considered as illegal actions, which is not the case in the United States, for example. So it's all the financial incentives concerning party and deputy financing, political action committees contribution, PACs. And we have examples, many, many examples. Well, the Monsanto Protection Act is an amendment slipped into a budget bill for agriculture in the United States 2 years ago. According to this amendment, the American justice can no longer oppose the cultivated genetically modified plants, even if they have not received approval. So they are illegal. And NGOs suspect a Republican senator from Missouri, which is the Monsanto's man in Washington, as the author of this amendment. So financial incentives is a way to obtain support for at the political level from deputies and parties. But, well, let's say that it's at a point that in European institutional environment, as I said, it's not very easy to observe and to study. Another important form of political strategy is what we call the constituency building, which is indeed stakeholder coalitions to gain support concerning an issue. Many examples of that. Association, business associations such as Business Roundtable. It's a very important business association in the United States. Defeating a lot of issues, especially an antitrust bill and the plan of a consumer protection agency. They have blocked these projects. They have blocked labor law reform also. We have many examples from the pharmaceuticals industry concerning collusion with scientific experts about, let's say, for example, cholesterol norms. You know that patients of cholesterol have doubled during the 20 last years all over the world because the norms are lower. That means that you are considered as a patient with not a very dangerous rate of cholesterol. And this was the effect of campaigns and constituency building of the pharmaceutical industry with experts. Rand Corporation and the National Bureau of Economic Research have argued that price control over drugs are against innovation and counterproductive in the long term, etc., etc. So the idea is that we have a number of factors that are concerned by an issue and take the positions that goes to the sense of the interests of the firm. Another form is the advocacy advertising, which is paid messages to support a particular social, environmental, or political issue. Many campaigns of firm campaigns concerning doing responsibly, a beer maker, Diet Coke, which is presented as a better nutritional alternative, and so on. And of course, direct lobbying, which is diffusing information to influence the policymakers, the legislators, or members of the regulatory agencies, with a well-known phenomenon of capture of the legislator. Because, of course, when you have, for example, a regulatory agency concerning competition or any kind of issue, the members of these agencies need to be in interaction with firms in order to define appropriate goals and policies But the most they are in contact with the firm representatives, the more are influenced by the point of view of the firm. And this is a point that it's a well-known point concerning regulatory agencies, and there is no solution about that, because if you decide to don't have this contact, you mean that to take the risk to take non-relevant decisions. So, direct lobbying also is very important, and in Europe also, where the spirits were not ready to accept that till 20 years ago. Now everybody talks about lobbying without having always the institutional framework to control and to keep the lobbying activities in, let's say, in transparent way. For example, in France, you don't have any legislation about lobbying. You have legislation, you have rules concerning the European Commission, but in France you don't have any body and law body concerning this type of actions. Well, of course, these different forms of political strategies can be combined, of course, and what is happening generally. There is the question of corruption. As I said, corruption is an illegal practice, even if cultural and institutional factors have to be taken into account in order to define what is illegal. What is illegal in France is not in France, but it's not necessarily illegal in China. It's not necessarily illegal in an African country, and so you have to take into account that. But from my point of view concerning this presentation, I consider that frontiers with other political strategies are quite porous. So the fact that we don't talk about corruption when we talk about political strategies in the literature, I mean, it makes problem for me, but I come back to this point at the last part of my presentation if we have enough time. Well, generally, research in international business is much more infused with a consideration of political strategies than literature on firm strategies, domestic strategies, let's say. Well, this seems natural because authors on multinationals have constantly mentioned and emphasized government as a variable, an important variable, because international activity always implies operating under a great variety of evolving political regimes that have an impact on firms' performances, firms' entry, operation, and eventually exit on the market. What, after presenting these general elements concerning political strategies, what is the main, the focus of my presentation today? Is the general, the central idea of the paper that you have. The idea is that multinationals, political firms do not develop in a vacuum, and they are conditioned generally by firm specificities, industry specificities, environmental factors, etc. And in particular, political strategies are implemented in the framework of more or less organized and structured interaction with governments. More or less because we can have interactions that are informal ones. As I have interactions that are formalized. So more or less organized and structured interactions. And in order to understand what this is, the idea that we defend in this paper, my co-author, that is that in order to understand political strategies, it's necessary to understand the interaction patterns linking multinationals and governments, and so their institutional determinants. Well, I begin with the presentation of the perceptions concerning Yemeni's state relations. These perceptions have evolved significantly during the last 30 years from theories and theoretical propositions that point out the conflictual nature of these relations to theories and propositions that point out the interdependencies existing between multinational firms and state. Well, the conflict-based approaches are based on, they suppose, an incompatibility of interests of the two parties. Conflicts arise about rent sharing, threat of delocalization, technology transfers, part of locally produced value added, etc. The underlying hypothesis concerning especially relations with the host countries is that the multinational firm's best strategic option is generally not the best for the country. Well, we have a lot of expressions of this approach. We can refer to the Teoria de la Dependencia, which was developed especially from Latin American authors. Where the multinational firm is considered as the main expression of neo-imperialism, the major vector of dependence and exploitation of the periphery. This approach was developed especially in the 60s and 70s. And logically, dependency approaches, dependencia approaches, imply a convergence of interests between the multinational firm and the home country, but conflict with the host country. We have also all the body based on Vernon's seminal work on obsolescing bargaining. Vernon has proposed that there is an evolution of a multinational bargaining power after its settlement in a host country. And all these studies are based on the idea that the host countries may impose a renegotiation of the initial agreement and thus force multinationals to accept a low control by the parent company. Other authors have adopted the hypothesis of the state's subordination to the multinational interests. We have some French representatives of this approach, as André Michelet did. Well, concerning these conflict-based approaches, even if it's not clearly conflict-based in the obsolescing bargaining model, two major criticisms have been expressed. The first one is that multinationals and state goals are not formulated independently, but are defined over an interaction process which is structured by interdependencies and mutual influences. The second criticism is that multinationals and states are not monolithic entities. That means that their internal, for both multinationals and states, internal organizational and institutional differences are sometimes greater than the external differences between states and between firms. Let's look a little bit more at these two points. Regarding the first point, the fact that there is an interdependence between MNEs and states, new international political economy research work, Gilpin, for example, insists on the everlasting central role of the state in the relation to the multinationals, referring mainly, let's say, to the United States. In this framework, multinationals are the expression of states' expansionism and global goals of foreign policy. Pax Americana, for example, offering the political frame for transnational activities. According to this school, not only is the state fully present face to the multinationals, but the latter, multinationals, would not emerge and develop without a strong political power, strong political power ensuring a favorable international environment. It is to be understood that the obsolescing bargaining model too, while emphasizing the role of state policies in forcing multinationals to accept a weakening of the mother firm's control, show a progressive shift towards the recognition of common interests, given that both parties earn more if the investment multinational firm becomes effective. We have also the literature on built-up localization advantages, Porter, which stresses the growing interest interlinks between the state and the private actors. And furthermore, the generalization of strategic policies inspired by the Krugman's proposals or the economic war policies have made the defense of national interest closely linked to that of at least some big local companies. In many cases, interests converge. The multinationals acting as good citizens in order to benefit from national support policies that offer multinationals decisive competitive advantage. We have even reports of the OECD that points out this kind of relations. And we have generally the idea that states and multinationals form coalitions. Often, the relation of the two parties is described as that of bilateral monopoly, characterized also by interdependence and also indeterminacy of final outcomes. We don't know what will happen because this relation is evolutive, and in every bilateral monopoly, the outcome is depends on the negotiation process indeed. We can also mention the political bargaining models who stress that the density of repeated interactions favors the rising up of common interests. The general idea is that the ties linking multinationals and states often stand on a reciprocity balance and mutual dependency. I have to say that the criticism addressed to the traditional approaches, conflict-based approaches, does not mean that the relations between multinationals and governments are harmonious and without conflict. The divergences of interest can be deep, even with the home countries, as one often can observe in cases of delocalization and closing down of factories. Recently, some big American firms have decided to delocalize their production to Europe because following the pressures of conservatives, the American state do not finance anymore, or not cover anymore risks in overseas operations. General Electric decided to delocalize a part of its production in France, for example. So it does mean there is no conflict, but it's a question of underlying the interdependencies, the idiosyncratic character of their interactions, and the multinationals' capacity to promote their own interests and to impact public policies through the development of suitable assets. Regarding the second criticism, the fact that multinationals and states have not to be considered as monolithic entities, a lot of contemporary research work refute this representation. We have, for example, the Brewer's seminal work. Brewer stresses the variety of business-government relations and their outcomes across different domains inside one single country. That means that interconnections and mutual influence depend on each issue area. Some authors argue that the centrifugal forces do exist inside multinationals, with subsidiaries having to adapt to the economic and extra-economic conditions of foreign markets. Hillman and Wan formalized this idea with the institutional duality concept. That means the need of internal inside firms and external, it means by reference to the government, legitimacy. So multinational subsidiaries are faced with this, have to manage this institutional duality. So multinationals and states interactions imply different types of relationship according to the various issue areas. That means that interactions concerning issues, energy issues, will have different features, different procedures of interaction compared to issues concerning pharmaceutical industry, for example. Political decision making, and this is the proposition of the paper, political decision making occurs within inter-organizational networks of, namely, policy networks of lasting nature, which constitute the institutional environment of business-government relationships. Well, policy networks is a concept that comes steamed from political science, and defines systems of intermediation of interests And in the paper, firm political strategies, we consider that firm political strategies are defined in reference to the policy networks in which multinationals are involved. One of the most interesting contributions of the policy networks literature is precisely the idea that we have specific interaction patterns in special areas of public policy. That means that interest groups, firms, bureaucrats, and politicians interact within multiple networks, policy networks, representing a diversity of stakeholders' relational patterns. That means that the possibilities to influence government decisions, policy making, the political strategies by themselves are not similar either. What the concept of policy network adds to the issue area approach is the possibility to integrate the institutional characteristic of various issue areas into the analysis and mainly study the integration, stability, exclusivity relations, dominant interests, and so on. In the literature, we can distinguish two polar types of policy networks. To simplify, let's say, the open and closed ones. Inside a closed policy network, strong ties imply dense relationships of a small number of public and private actors. The members are isolated from external influences and have shared interests, values, preferences, and even ideology. This type of network is characterized by high centralization, cohesion, convergence, and exclusivity, and constitutes an institutional environment suitable to build up a dominant position inside a specific issue area. What the politicists call the iron triangles, with very dense interactions between these three categories of actors, politicians, bureaucrats, and interest groups. The open, at the other extreme, the open policy networks are characterized by weak ties among a high number of participants with, let's say, well-balanced bargaining power and little interdependence because of low centralization, low density, low cohesion, interconnectivity is lacking, and contacts are generally weak and distant. Without dominant or systematically favored interests, actors' interactions are based on consultations and exchanges of information. Of course, what the literature considers, following also the ideas proposed, developed by Granovetter, is that open network procures more information, but also implies loose links which weaken the influence of participating actors. On the other hand, closed networks are poorer in information, but constitute institutional environments which, as I said, are suitable to build up a dominant position inside a specific issue area. The literature on firms' political strategies stresses the importance of some specific no market assets, time devoted to political action by company executives, specific organizational skills to mobilize external partners, for example, access to strategic information or to state or government officials, managers' expertise, know-how and skills in dealing with different stakeholders, social reputation of the firm, capability to formulate clearly strategic objectives concerning social issues, specific information as regard the process of political decision making, also knowing the orientation of the political agenda and be able to legitimate the firm goals. So we have a great number of no market assets, which are the determining factors of a firm's political leverage. In this paper, we consider as a proxy of the firm's no market assets the nature and number of its links, the multinational links with other stakeholders. That means the multinational structural position inside the relevant policy network. Well, there are different measures concerning this structural position. This comes out from the social networks and graphs theory. If you have some questions concerning these more technical points, we can discuss about that later. Questions like centrality, strength of links, exclusivity of links, and so on. Now I propose to you to go further in the presentation of the taxonomy of different institutional environments, referring to the policy, the nature of policy networks and the multinationals' position inside the network, in order to appreciate the different types of political leverage in the home country. So we have this simple matrix that you have in the paper. According, as I said, to the institutional characteristics and the multinational's structural position inside the policy network of the concerned domain. That means we talk at the level of one specific issue area. Each quadrant defines a certain degree of influence in home politics. The first cell, A, represent an open institutional structure of the corresponding policy network combined with a strong position of the firm. The firm controls important resources and is well inserted into the network, but its influence has to be negotiated with a variety of other actors having also enough power and eventually rival goals, other interest groups, NGOs, so on. Since there is no exclusivity and dominance, policy options will mainly emerge as compromises, acceptable compromises, and the outcome concerning the firm's political leverage is uncertain and unpredictable. Of course, this does not exclude the possibility to promote specific interests through stakeholders' alliances. That's why we have called the situation negotiated power. In the second cell, B, the integration in home countries' closed policy networks and the control of relevant non-market assets enable a firm to pursue effective political influence strategies. So the firm is in a dominant position. Its political leverage is significant, linked by a permanent coalition. The government and the firms have common goals and back one another. In the third case, the firm is not integrated, or it occupies a relatively weak position in the relevant policy network. As a consequence, it does not benefit from political leverage, although it may exert a certain economic power. At the same time, rival interests do not dominate the domain either, given the open character of the network. That means, from an operational point of view, a great autonomy for the firm's strategic choices, but leaves with limited political support. The last configuration, D, corresponds to an issue area dominated by other and possibly rival interests or by strong state agencies imposing their own goals, given the firm's weak insertion in the corresponding closed policy network. In this case, multinationals can not only lack political support, but also bear negative political externalities with respect to their activities. We can give some examples, if you want, concerning this type of situation. The other point is, and this is another idea that we have developed in this paper, is that there is a link between multinationals' political leverage at home and strategies or approaches adopted concerning the host countries. And this was, let's say, an interesting point of the paper, because generally, in the literature, we study one or the other, not both together. So the idea is that political leverage in the home country and host countries' bargaining power will affect the firm's strategic choices. This is what we have tried to explain with this figure. It is important to notice that the features of specific issue areas have an influence on this interactive game and a crucial impact on the host country's actors by gaining power. What does it mean? It means that states with enough economic strength, political will, action capabilities can be moderately interested in specific domains. For example, a French state has not supported its aluminium industry, Pechiney, which was acquired by Alcan in the beginning of this century. Also, the state's action can be weakened because of high policy-making fragmentation, situations that we can observe in China, for example. Conversely, relatively weak host countries can reveal important bargaining power in some domains, as we have seen concerning water issues in Argentina and Bolivia. If we see the different parts of this figure, dominant positions in closed home policy networks or the capacity to constitute stakeholder alliances in open ones involve strong support for the home government. If the host country's actors have also an important bargaining power in the corresponding issue area, the firm might follow a supranational and macro-political influence approach. That means that the game is more complex. Goals and aspirations are mutually adapted, and the outcome is unpredictable. In some cases, jointly with home governments, multinationals can negotiate the establishment of international standards and rules, as for example concerning the protection of intellectual property, the removal of entry barriers, and so on, at the level of supranational institutions as the World Trade Organization. Such an approach increases the cost borne by the host state if it intends to implement unfriendly policies, and usually is supplemented by transnational alliances. Ramamuthi developed a two-tier multi-pattern bargaining model where institutionalized countries use the tier one, which is the multilateral bargaining, to weaken the hand of host governments in the tier two bargaining while strengthening the power of their multinationals. Conflictual bargaining concerning some medicines, drugs, for the treatment of AIDS, for example, with countries like South Africa or India and the big pharma multinationals, are an interesting example of this kind of situation. When host countries, no corruption. When host countries, actors, and government have weak bargaining power, multinationals with political leverage at home will be tempted to adopt a concurring approach, imposing unbalanced relationship patterns. This is the era B. Also, the home government can exert a direct influence and seriously impair sovereignty of host countries, given support to the multinationals, as, for example, for the exploitation of raw materials of privatization programs. In the case of a peripheral position in the relevant policy networks at home, multinationals' international strategy is left to rely solely on tangible and intangible market assets. That means that the firm should manage a more balanced bargaining configuration, and consequently it will be under pressure of national isomorphism, in particular if its own structure is decentralized. Is the case for some multinationals. When the host country's actors' bargaining power is high enough, the firm will be forced to adopt an adaptive approach, searching local legitimacy and taking into account the expectations and interests of local actors, showing receptiveness to public authority requests, especially if its activity belongs to a special domain, a sovereignty domain of the host country, as for example the defense industry. When at the contrary the host country's actors have a weak bargaining power, the firm, multinational firm, might tend to build up a certain micropolitical influence, exploiting its specific ownership advantages and developing exclusive relationships inside some sectors or regions of the host country. This possibility also depends on the host country's size and administrative institutional diversity that could allow the existence of protected political niches. Finally, multinationals will pursue hybrid strategies when the balance of power is not well established. Well, that is the main points of the paper. I think that we don't have enough time to talk about corruption, but just some words, and maybe we can come back to this point during the discussion. Corruption is generally presented as a threat for business, but it can also be the driving force to build market power by non-market means. Multinationals' international strategies may generate corruption by trying to promote their own interests. Indeed, OECD's countries, which have anti-bribery laws, these bribery laws are weakly enforced in foreign markets, and it's quite interesting to see that the attractiveness of some major foreign direct investment recipients, BRICS for instance, seems related to the possibility of using widespread corruption. Well, that's why I consider that it's really an important point. And once again, we have to examine what are the institutional structure, institutional conditions generally, in the host countries, which will affect the multinationals' tendency to bribe. Well, I have tried to develop an analytical grid about that, but if you have some specific questions concerning this point, we can discuss about that. So, thank you for your attention.
Thank you to Mr. Rizopoulos for coming and to share his understanding with us. And now, Xiangwan and me are going to give a brief summary about the policy network and the multinational enterprises. Our presentation is structured by the following table of content. First, I'm going to explain one a little introduction and policy networks concepts, and Xian Wang is going to explain the multinational enterprises and the relationship with the home countries and the host countries. And then we have some conclusions and comments and then questions. First, well, it's necessary to understand what is a policy network. A policy network is an analytical tool of the intermediate levels of government, which gives the possibility to contextualize the framework of the multinational network's political strategies. In other words, the policy network is a framework of structured interactions between the government and the multinational enterprises. In this case, we have in one part the multinational enterprises that are characterized by some power in terms of employability, finance, or technology. And this power makes possible that the multinational enterprises have some influence in the political decision-making process. And also, this influence also depends on the role of the government, because we can have a government that is serving the interests of the multinational enterprises, or the government could have some control so they dominate the multinational enterprises' strategies. And whatever will be the interaction, there is also the links between the multinationals and the government. These links are based on the reciprocity balance and mutual dependency. And well, the multinational enterprises consider or take into account the policy network where they are involved in order to construct their political strategies. So they know how to negotiate inside the policy network, and they interact with the government actors in order to talk about their important issues related to their activity. And well, we have that the multinational networks implemented the political strategies in the policy network. And then we have the relation with the policy network with the issue areas. It's important to note that we have a wide range of policy network because we have the interest groups, the politicians, and the bureaucrats, and they are interacting in different and multiple policy networks. So they have different influence and they have a different bargaining potential. So we have that in one single country, we can have many different types of policy networks. And according to Breuer, these different interactions have relation, depends on the issue area. And we said that the issue areas approach is complement to the policy network approach, and we have the institutional features of policy network differentiate the business and the government interactions and the multiple and the multinational enterprises political leverage in each issue area. Then we have the policy network character closed or opened. It depends on the structural variables that we have in this table. And as you can see, the closed network, we have higher centralization than in the open network. And we have a small number of actors in this network. We also have a social dimension in which there is an exclusion of actors. And also, we have the higher density, and we have that the actors in this case are very linked, and so that's why we have a strong ties between them. And but there is a problem in the cognitive dimension, because it's not possible to have the ability of see the reality outside the network. And also we have that it's possible in this closed network to have a dominant position, because there is a dominance, but in the open network is not possible. And well, we have a higher connectivity, but it depends on the existence of the cliques inside the association between the individuals. And we have also that the closed network have some disadvantages because there are poor information if we compare it with the open network. And one advantage is that there is not a structural holes in this network. In the case of the open network, the main disadvantage is that there is not possibility to have a dominant position inside the network, but there is much information than in the closed network. And well, finally, we have that the multinational enterprises have more possibility to have a dominant position in the closed network than in an open network. And then we have the impact of the multinational enterprises' structural position. In this case, we have that multinational enterprises have a market and non-market assets, but we emphasize the importance of the non-market assets because among the non-market assets is included the access to strategic information. And for example, the strategic information about the political decision-making process, about the orientation of the political agenda, or how to find the legitimization of the firm's goals. And these non-market assets are rare, sustained, and is not easily imitated. So that's why have a strategic value. And we have also that the non-market assets are the factors that determine a firm's capacity to influence in the public policies. As a proxy of the non-market assets, the author used in the paper the board measures of power in order to give an idea of the structure positioned inside the policy network. And we have in this case the centrality that are the links the possible, the effective link that we have inside the policy network, but in comparison to the all the possible ones links that we have. And in the case of intermediate centrality, is the position in the minimum path, length path that that makes possible to the connection with other participants inside the network. And another measure is the strength of links, and is about the strong connections between participants inside the network. Also, we have the exclusivity of links, that is the degree of the participants of other participants exclusive relationships, and we have also the power of every participant in the network and the structural holes that implies that is not redundant relationships between the actors in the network. And we have, for instance, so we have that the political leverage is determined by the structural position that the multinational enterprise take inside the network, the policy network. And then Xiang Wang is going to explain the multinational enterprise and relation with Hong Kong.
So thank you for Fatima and Professor's presentation. And as we have seen this diagram, this table before, so I will just quickly go through the idea and give you some example. So as Fatima has mentioned earlier, that MNE has more possibility to influence the public decisions by a closed network. And now we're going to take into viral role into consideration and to see how it's going to how the MNE is going have a position on the marketplace. So if MNE have an open network combined with a strong position, they are in a negotiated power. So in this case, the MNE, they have the very strong political strength, and however, there is no they still have to be negotiate with other market player as well. So the MNE, they have no exclusivity and dominance in this market position. So the MNE's political leverage is very uncertain and unpredictable, but it is still possible that by alliance with other groups with common interest, they can build some, they can promote their ideas together. And a certain and a typical example is that multi-actor bargaining in the European Union countries concerning the regulation and privatization of public utilities. And for MNE, in a closed network and inside with a strong position, MNE is in a dominant place. So in this case, MNE, they have a very strong control of the resources, and it also enable MNE to pursue effective political influence strategies. And government, MNE, they back up each other. A famous example is a Boeing company, because American government, they sponsor Boeing company approve the antitrust law to approve that the Boeing can emerge other two aircraft manufacturing in the American markets. So when MNE in an open policy network combined with a weak position, there is no certain they don't enjoy the political leverage, but in the marketplace there is no certain they don't have a certain dominate as well. So it's in an autonomy position. When MNE is in a closed policy network and in a very weak position, it is in a predominant position. And for example, and at the same time, the MNE, they don't have the political leverage, and they also suffer the negative political externalities with respect to its activities. And a famous example is that a Canadian company, they involved with exploitation of Sudan oil field. However, it received many international negative comments and also some human rights group criticism. So at the end, the Canadian company, they forced to exit this market. And now, since we've talked about the relationship between the multinational company and the home country's relationship, and there is another very important factors we need to take into account. It is the host country's bargaining power, and I'm just giving you here some brief ideas, and then we will look into more detail in the next slides. And first of all, the subsidiary develop their own powerful resources and micro-political can take place. And a famous example of Volkswagen Group subsidiaries in Mexico and Brazil, they formulate this idea. And in this case, the subsidiary, they need to search both internal and external legitimacy. For another, with economic strength, political will can be interested in specific domain. For example, there is an aluminum company, and at first place, the French government didn't have very interest on them. But after the aluminum company is emerged by another major company, the French supported this company because of its economic strength. For another, state action can be weakened because of the high policymaking fragmentation. And take China as an example, because it is a very big country. So some firms, they want to enter this market instead of negotiating directly with the central government. So they try to negotiate with the local governments because local governments, they can benefit from the employment opportunity and also the taxation. Taxation benefits. So in this case, the MNE will prefer to deal with the local government instead of the central government. Yeah, it's going to be very quick. So we've seen that in a dominant position and a strong bargaining power, the MNE can have a supranational influence power. So in this case, the goals and aspirations are mutually adopted, and the outcome is unpredictable. So take example that under the regulation of telecom markets in Europe. And also, MNE can negotiate international standards and rules at the level of supranational institutions like WTO. And if the governments, if the MNE is in a weaker position, they are in a dominant position, but in a very relatively weaker local. The local government is with weaker bargaining power. The MNE is adopted a conquering approach. The famous example is that Argentina in the 19th centuries, and because there are many multinational enterprises, they enter the market and they take whatever they want. And also their home, the MNE's home country level, they can have a direct impact through the multinational enterprise and to take those raw materials. So when in an adaptive approach, both multinational enterprise and other market players, they are not in a dominant place. So they just search legitimacy and show the receptiveness to authorities, especially defense industry. So for another one, when MNE is in with weaker the local government is with weaker bargaining power, and MNE is in a political influence position, and MNE they exploit their ownership advantage and develop exclusive relationship of host countries. For example, like US ceramic manufacturer in Bulgaria, they try to help those local government and helped them to provide many employee opportunities, and it's also above the national average. They also help them to renovate some hospitals and schools. And they also, in terms of the size, like China, we can also allow the existence of the political niche. So this is the last one, the hybrid approach, because with the balance of power is now well established in this market, and this is like a safe play. So the MNE they can use like both supranational approach and adaptive approach as well. Okay, so I'm just going to give a very quick conclusion. So when we're decided a political strategy of an MNE, we should take the firm and the industry and the environmental into consideration. And it is also necessary to understand that the interaction pattern between the multinational company, government, and the institutions, they all should be determined. So here is our comment and questions. So like after this, and maybe professor, you can give us our feedbacks. And so my first comment is that the paper mostly examines the relationship between the government and the MNE in host countries and home countries level. But in reality, there are still several cases like multinational host countries, they can influence the home country level and to make the home country level MNE to influence other host country levels, because oftentimes home country multinational enterprise, they just have the very limited resources. So the host countries, they have to compete their resource with each other. And is it going to be like take into consideration when we decide a M&E strategy as well? And for my second question is that there is another type of multinational company. It's called transnational company. And there is slight difference between them. So let's look at the definition of transnational company. It doesn't identify itself with one national home. So different from multinational company, transnational company, they don't have a home country. So transnational, they also just spread out the operations in many countries. The famous example is Nestle. And so if in this case, can transnational company, they also adapt all the strategies and all the theories we talk about in this paper? Then my last question is, M&E in host countries, they can exist in several types of the entities like subsidiaries and branch and joint venture. And it's all, I think there is a certain level of decentralization of the home country level. But is this three types of the entities, they can all adopt the same approach as M&E host countries, or we need to have a different strategy on them? For a certain level of decentralization, like CEO and some upper level management, they are local hire, or they are designated by the home country, by the parent company. And is it going also like we need to adopt the same approach, or use the same one or adopt another one?
I also have some questions for Mr. Rizopoulos, and well, I found in the theory that some researchers pointed out the difference between the multinational enterprises in emerging countries from emerging country and the ones from the industrialized economies. So if we have the difference between those multinational enterprises, we can still using the strategic approach for those multinational, or is there any difference? So this is my question, and because the emerging multinationals have less experience after industrialized ones, so they face more barriers in the market. And the other question is about the business diplomacy concept, because it's a new concept about involve developing strategies for long term and have to be with the positive relationship building with government and local communities. So there is inclusion of other stakeholders that are different from the governments. And if we can consider that the business diplomacy as part of the strategic approach, for example, in the adaptive approach that we have before, and in the case of the multinational enterprise relations with the host countries. And that is all. Thank you so much.
Very rapidly. Well, thank you for this very complimentary presentation, because you have summarized very well the content of the paper, and more, you have given examples. So it's a very useful way to complete my own presentation. Thank you very much. And I think that the message was very clear indeed, so there's no any problem of understanding of what is writing down in the paper indeed. So thanks a lot. Just a very, very minor point concerning the example of the French government attitude concerning the aluminium industry. It's the contrary. It means that France, which is quite, let's say, strong country, in this case, did not support French industry in it. So, but it's not very important. Okay, you have already said all the important things concerning the difference between open and closed policy networks. So it's okay, I don't have anything to add on this point. So just concerning your questions. Is there any difference between transnational corporations and multinational corporations? Well, we know that there are very few cases of multinational firms that have lost their national identity, which are really transnational corporations, but they are not a lot. Most of them keep still very tight relationship with the home country and the home government. So you have to examine the situation case by case, but generally what happens is that we have in some situations like Europe, we have now multinationals that have links not with each specific country, like for example the plane industry, aircraft industry, Airbus, which is a European enterprise now. And so you cannot find links specifically with the French government or with the German government, but it's all over the European countries that participate in the consortium that you can have political actions at the European Union level also. So it's a kind of transnational corporation which is not strictly linked with a specific country. But in most cases, even in very big countries, in very big companies like Exxon, like energy sector companies, you have still quite tight relations with the home government, especially when the home government is have a very specific and important geopolitical role, as is the case in the American government. So it depends also on the countries, it depends on a lot of things, but American multinationals have still support of American government is very important concerning the different activities that they have in the rest of the world. It's not exactly the same when you talk about multinationals from emerging countries. But for example, in this case, we have also attitudes and strategies that it's quite similar. For example, Chinese multinationals in Africa have exactly the same type of approach as can have American multinationals in Asia and in Latin America. So it depends a lot on the power of the country, on the political action capabilities of the country, its possibility to influence international, supranational organizations, and so on. But it's difficult to give a very general answer to this question, but my feeling is that generally the link is quite close, and the attitudes and strategic approaches do not differ, except if you have if it's the home government, for example, don't have the possibility to push you an active policy, not have clear political objectives, and so on, which is possible. But well, generally, political support plays an important role even for multinationals from emerging countries. You said that usually or sometimes you have not an intermediation by government, but have just firm-to-firm relations, indeed, if I understand your first question. Well, it's clearly the case when you don't have any political leverage. Means that if a multinational firm don't have any political leverage at home, for example, it's the most important thing is it's tangible and tangible market assets. That means that there is no market assets in this case, so it's possible. And you have, indeed, quite a lot of multinationals that don't use because they don't have enough political power. So it's an interaction maybe at the host country at the local level, or it's an interaction between firms and partners, in joint ventures. In the case of joint ventures, for example, the outcome is unpredictable, as you can say. But it's when you don't have enough political support. Well, concerning the situation of subsidiaries, even if in the majority of cases multinationals are characterized by strong centralization, but their structure is quite complex, and sometimes you can have substantial autonomy at the level of subsidiaries. And you have even some cases of multinationals who traditionally have had problems to control what happened at the subsidiary level. It's not the majority, but if you take the example of a multinational as Philips, in the electronic sector, well, they are not really anymore in the electronic sector. They have let it down, what is audio and video products. But during many years after the Second World War, they have serious problems to control what the strategies and decisions of the American subsidiary, for historical reasons, because the American subsidiary was developed in a quite autonomous way during the Second World War, and headquarters in Holland didn't have any possibility to influence, even concerning technical choices, even concerning adoption of innovations that have emerged in other parts of the, in other subsidiaries of the group. They were quite autonomous. But well, it's a specific case. If you compare Philips with other, for example, Japanese companies in the same sector, Matsushita is very centralized sector. So it's they have the opposite problem. They don't have enough innovative capacity because they control everything. But so you can have different situations. That's why you have propositions saying that in some cases, multinationals inside the firm, you can have much more differences than you can imagine. And you can have, and we know that are cases where subsidiaries of the same group, of the same multinational firm, enter in a competition to gain some markets. It's possible also. But my feeling is that it's a small part of the cases that we see. So the business diplomacy. But business diplomacy is a general term. Business diplomacy is a general term to signify the fact that multinationals play a political role. What kind of political role depends on the institutional framework, on the capacities, no market access, and so on. But generally, it's accepted now that firms, in general, and specifically multinational firms, are political actors. That means that they play a role at the political level in the sense of their own interests, of course, but which can have an impact on more general political questions and actions, like wars, for example. We know very well that business diplomacy of the energy sector in the United States is at the origin of quite a few conflicts in the world, indeed. Well, but business diplomacy can be also to promote some norms or some specific rules concerning the function of the markets and so on. So it can take multiple faces. Indeed. But, well, it's a convergence in the fact that now big firms and the international firms play an important role, all political actors. I don't know if I respond to your questions. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you for presentation. My question is concerning lobbying. I heard zero time this word during the presentation, but I think somehow it should be connected. We were talking about
excuse me. It should be connected with what?
Lobbying.
Lobbying with what?
With all that we
Yes, of course.
I want to how networks can how different types of networks can correspond with a lobbying, and where is the line or the border between lobbying and corruption? Thank you.
My question is more about corruption, because you were telling that in different countries there are different types of corruption, like in Eastern Europe or in Central Asia, maybe it's different from Latin America or Africa. So I was wanted to ask, I was interested in if it affects entry modes of these multinational enterprises, and what types of entry modes you can differ the entry modes, the pairing of entry of market mode, depending on different types of corruption in host country, or even maybe it depends on home country corruption type.
So I have another question, which is quite related to what Fatima already asked you. At one point, you talked about new economic geography in your presentation. And you said that a state creates positive externalities for their home country industry or like enterprises firms. But at the same time, there are other non-market actors. And I'm talking right now specifically with respect to pharmaceutical sector. That not only they in a way create the market. They recommend policies, for example, WHO, or they say that we will only buy such kind of products that are approved or that have a certain level of standards. So they create in a way a market where only few firms can enter, and so it is a positive externality, but it might or it might not benefit the firms from host country. What do you have to say about this kind of actors and how firms from both host and like foreign MNEs, they interact with this kind of organizations?
If I understood well, it's what is the relation between the positive externalities that a home country creates and strategies that are developed by the multinationals, pharmaceuticals, for example, to impede the enter in the market of other competitors, indeed,
yes, or to develop. But externalities, in fact, created by non-market actors, like, for example, World Health Organization, creates regulations,
yes.
And it, in fact, creates a market, which is suited only for certain firms, but not for others. So others are excluded.
Forms of what? Other forms of enterprise, other forms of products, other what?
For example, for malaria. WHO says that the best treatment right now that we think is to use a combination therapy, okay? But there are only few firms that can produce that therapy. So the past treatment, of course, the past market for other treatments was gone because another organization which gives international funding, like Global Fund, says that, okay, we will not give you money to countries that have less bargaining power to buy any other medicine that WHO doesn't recommend. So the government of a country has to change their policy according to the recommendation of WHO. So it creates a market where host firms might not even be able to survive, and it might not even benefit, and it can benefit firms from like international companies, MNEs, something like this. Sorry.
Another question?
I would have a question in regards to multinational universities, and it's an emerging phenomenon right now, and they're very often compared to multinational corporations. And if you can comment if they would have the same political networks as the multinational corporations, and any comments that you have on it would be interesting.
Okay. I have a question. There will be one round of questions because we decided to. So
last chance. Okay, my question is about we received Jean-Louis Beffa last week. So he talked about multinational enterprise as a former CEO of Saint-Gobain. And he told us about the importance of history, the importance also on relying on local leaders. So what do you think in the creation of policy networks about the about relying on really local leaders instead of people coming from the home country and going to the host country? So to what extent did you see in your work that the enterprises that succeed more rely more also on local leaders? And we are now discussing, I don't know if it's at the European level or the French level, about a law for protecting whistleblowers, les lanceurs d'alerte. So what do you think could be the effect of such a law protecting people, warning about illegal decisions or corruptions or things like that?
You mean if we...
No
we
other questions? Okay, up to you.
Well, very interesting questions. Thank you. Well, I'm not sure that I have answer to all this, but... what is the link between lobbying and policy networks, and is there any frontier with corruption? There is a legal frontier, but you have to know very well all the aspects of this interactive game to say that there is no corruption, it's just lobbying. And usually it's very difficult to know it. That's the problem. Because you have, for example, concerning the European Union, you have some formalized procedures now to, let's say, to allow this contact between group interests or firms and the European Commission. Well, is it strictly exchange of information? Do you know what the responsible of a commission discuss with the representative of a firm in his bureau? You cannot know exactly what it happens, and sometimes things happens outside the commission, in the restaurant, in the coin. So it's clear that you need some regulatory framework to manage, to try to have a more transparent situation. But the fact is that it's always difficult to know exactly what happens. So from a legal point of view, you know that corruption is when you give favors for having private gain. But even the favors is not always simply money. It can be very many other things indeed. Your children will be accepted in a very high-level university in the United States, for example. This is not a direct type of corruption, but of course it's a game. And you can make favors for that. So the problem is that it's very difficult to know what happens. Yes. Normally lobbying is a legal procedure to have this exchange of point of view between policymakers and interest groups. If it's followed by some gifts, it's no anymore strictly legal corruption or legal lobbying. It's other thing. But it's case by case. You can't. The problem is that we know that powerful firms will not hesitate to use multiple ways to influence political decision making. Well, I have had the experience during the transition, the first years of the transition, the former socialist countries have some investigations inside the energy sector. And my question, or one of my questions to some, let's say, high-level executives in this industry, the energy industry, is if they allow themselves to use corruption practices to enter in these markets. And almost all the times the answer was, but the problem is that anyway, it was not a direct answer, but the answer was, anyway, if we don't do it, others will do. So you understand what you can understand, but anyway, if I have to do it, I'll do it. Well, it's very interesting to know that we have concerning, I have had some elements concerning the part of my presentation that you have at this moment in the OECD countries, you have laws against the bribing. Executives of the multinational firms have inquiries. They don't know these laws. And of course, naturally, they don't apply these laws when they are abroad. They take care inside the country where they are, but when they are abroad, they don't care about that. They do what they seem interesting to do to gain the market. So, well, the frontiers are porous. That's the problem.
Thank you for your comment. I just want to reply a bit. From your comment, I understood. I'm from Ukraine. And Ukraine is leader in corruption. Like it's something
yes,
that
there are many leaders in corruption.
No, no. Ukraine is.
You have different types. You have different types of.
And they really progress in it. You know, they do well. And but in Ukraine there is no such a thing as lobbying. So I think for Ukraine to fight corruption, maybe we can name a half of the corruption activities as a lobbying. So maybe it will be seen. There is no like. Legal framework for lobbying. So for enemies or big corporations, you have no this legal space to lobby your to your interests. You only can like corrupt person. So maybe I think maybe to like to put Ukraine a bit lower in this list of corrupted countries, maybe we can. Name part of these corruptions a lobbying, and then may have created some legal framework for lobbying, and maybe Ukraine can become more civilized. Like this. Okay, no, thank you for your comment. Thank you very much.
But you have different patterns of corruption in it. You have different patterns. You have let's take example of not Ukraine but France. No, of course. Of course, no. But this is in France. You have an institutionalized upper level corruption, which is not diffused in all the levels of the society. The differences compared to countries like Ukraine or like Greece, for example, is that you can have a diffused mode of corruption. Which it doesn't mean that when you have an institutionalized upper level corruption, it's not important because the major decisions are. Taken inside some iron triangles which link very tightly politicians, interest groups, and bureaucrats. But you don't see in France, for example, people who works in an agency generally, not always, but generally, will not imagine to ask some gifts to make favors and so on. This is the difference. But at the upper level, you can do it. Even let's say Well, the example of German firms, it's quite interesting. Well, this last weeks we know very well that there are lies and illegal practices, including in this not very corrupted country, let's say. But outside Germany, anyway, enterprises like Siemens don't hesitate. In every, almost in every country, they are implicated in corruption scandals. Well, so, well, if you have an institutional framework which is quite unstable, this favors this diffusion of corrupted practices. But if you have institutional stability, it doesn't mean that it does not exist. Simply, you don't see it because it's only at the very upper levels. Okay? Well, but it's there are interesting questions. But it's very interesting. When I investigated a little bit this this matter, it's very interesting this distance concerning legal procedures, laws, reglementations concerning corruption, and so on, and the ignorance from the firm's executives of the content of these laws. And as I said very, very quickly in my presentation, is that you have the recipients, the most important recipients of foreign direct investment are countries which are very, very low concerning corruption practice. That means that there are countries with a lot of corruption. You have to be very innocent man to think that all the firms that invest in these countries don't use it, and that that's just a local phenomenon for local firms. It's possible. Okay? So, well, so porous frontiers between then, and obviously, especially in the transition, what we have called the transition countries, the entry mode, it's difficult to say if it was just corruption, because you have had a bargaining power which was extremely disequilibrated during the first year of the transition, especially. And many multinationals have had predatory behavior concerning these countries, as was the case in Argentina during the 90s, for example. They want to get everything without giving. So it depends on the period, it depends on the institutional stability, the bargaining force of local governments and local actors in the specific issue area, as I said before. Okay.
Sorry, Professor, I'm going to hijack a question there. You said two things. Corruption is a driving force to build market power by non-market means. And also we talked about the policy network and the political influence.
But I wanted to ask about the sustainability of these policy networks in the long run. And since we talked about corruption, lobbying, or you call it whatever, since we're all economists, and or we pretend to be, regarding can you actually use a model of behavioral economics or game theory to predict and not just to he says, she say kind of, yeah, to predict patterns of corruptibility and multinationals and developing countries, transition economies? There must be a model, or there should be a model somewhere where we can actually put theory to use and not just he says, she says kind of thing. That's it.
Yes. Well, you have tentatives to discuss about corruption problems applying game theory. The problem is the game theory itself in order to apprehend this type of phenomenon. Because game theory, if we forgot a little bit its, let's say, elegance from the mathematical point of view, the initial assumptions are quite restrictive. Supposing, for example, perfect rationality of the players, which is far from being the case. Supposing strictly economic, interested economic behavior, which can be also the case sometimes, but not always. So I'm very reserved concerning the possibilities to explain phenomenon like corruption or using, you can do it as an intellectual exercise, but to understand exactly what happened, it seems to me not very relevant. Because we have a lot, a great complexity concerning the factors that intervene for this time. From my point of view, a less mathematical approach pointing out the institutional elements, the institutional factors, is more relevant to study this kind of problems. This is my opinion. Okay. The positive externalities and the repercussions concerning limitations about the competitive game, if I understand well. But obviously, even in these strategic approaches, Krugman's approaches and so on, the idea is to favor local enterprises and to give them more arguments, more possibilities to intervene and to enter foreign markets. And this means creating entry barriers for the others. The others can be firms from emerging countries that they try to find part of the market and to consolidate their existence. Can be firms from other developed countries. Anyway, the main idea is that when I create positive externalities for my own firms, if we suppose that I have my own firms, these positive externalities have a discretional power concerning the others. That means exclude the others. So it's absolutely normal that when I try to create a positive externality for my pharmaceutical industry, it's also to defend this industry against all the pressures that can have from newcomers that can be involved. That's from a firm point of view, it's quite normal. From an ethical point of view, it's another question. From the interests of the emerging countries, it's another question. But from the first point of view, it's quite normal. I don't know if I answer to your.
My point is that if the suppose government makes a policy for their their firms, right? But there is another third party that recommends, that makes another policy, and that creates.
A third party is what?
A third party is like United Nations or...
Yes, a supranational organization.
A supranational organization. That creates another policy which supersedes the policy of the state, especially in the developing countries.
There is negotiation between important countries and the supranational organization.
But for some countries, in some cases, the bargaining power is very, very small.
Of course.
Because they don't even have the industry, or industry is in the nascent stage. It is just born, especially in pharmaceutical industry. Most countries from the south, they cannot produce quality medicines. Or even if they produce, the quality standards, according to the quality standards, European quality standards, they don't pass. So if this supranational organizations create some recommendations, it creates a market, it creates an entry barrier.
Recommendations, technical norms, what is accepted, what is not accepted. I think for this kind of problem, the model, the two-tier model of Ramamurti's can be applied. Because indeed, the multinationals from, let's say, developed countries, this is the macro-political influence, as I said. They try to impose rules at the level of these supranational organizations, which facilitate their position and their bargaining with the home countries at the tier two. That means that it can be rules concerning competition, rules concerning what can we consider like an effective drug, all these kind of things. And of course, if all these things are decided at the upper level, this supranational level, when the multinational go to the home country, specific home country, the rules are here. You cannot say anything about that. You have to accept the rules. And this is a very complementary strategy with more direct political influence strategy that you can have on the level of the home country. Of course, it's complementary. Okay. I imagine the situations, but I don't know what really happened with the multinational universities. But it seems to me impossible to don't have political support in order to establish a university in an emerging or in a developing country. It's, from my point of view, it's impossible. And we have here, you know, in France, universities are public institutions, are not private institutions. And we have here, in this university, a quite interesting example of a master that we have created in economics, and also with our colleagues of Inalkov at political science, in Kazakhstan. Kazakhstan? Why in Kazakhstan? Even though we didn't have any specific strategic objective to create a master in economics in Kazakhstan, it was just a political push initiative. It has happened very, very quickly. In 6 months after a decision was taken at a very high level, you have already the Institut Sorbonne Kazakhstan, where when we enter, it's a very nice building. When you enter, we have a very big poster, our president with President Nazarbayev, which is very close and friendly. It's maybe linked to the fact that Kazakhstan has oil and uranium resources. We can imagine that. But, even for public universities, you have to be supported by political power to intervene in other countries. So, it seems obvious to me, but I don't have any specific information apart this anecdotic example of my own. It's another wall. It's political support does not exist for EPOG. David did not lobby anywhere for that. It appeared like that, and it's it's very intuitive answer, but it seems to me quite obvious for that. David, you asked about the importance of history and the impact of relying on more local leaders. I can say that an intelligent strategy for a multinational enterprise is to create, if it does not have, local leaders. If there are some and they agree to play this role, it's easier. If not, they have to create. They don't succeed everywhere at every time to do it. But local leaders attribute more legitimacy to the actions of, and this is anyway the constituency building. Local leaders can be a person, but can be also an organization. And once again, if we take the example of pharmaceutical industry, they are champions of that. In all cases, they, for example, to rally leaders of opinion, especially very known professors of big laboratories, research laboratories, they propose to write an article, where this known professor didn't write anything in the article, but published in a very good journal. This article, of course, says that the pharmaceutical protocol that is experienced by this industry is a very efficient one. Well, you have a leader of opinion that says that, anyway, that's a good thing to do. In foreign countries, it's the same principle. They will do exactly the same thing. Ghostwriting, they will try to rally important persons that will say, yes, it's very important to have a relation with them. And it is lobbying or corruption, I don't know, you have to see. But anyway, it's very important to legitimate your actions, to have local leaders. So I agree with that it's an important point. They don't succeed always to do it, because the game, once again, is very complex. And you can have opposite forces that, in some cases, can be efficient and saying, oh, no, it does work. But, well. And your question about law protecting protect. Yes, I'm not sure to that means concerning corrupted practices. But you have ONGs in all, not in all countries, but for example in the United States, where, you know, parenthesis, in Europe all these kind of things are quite recent historically. 20 years ago nobody talked about lobbying in Greece, in Europe, sorry. Because we have grown up with a general mentality and culture that we are all equal in front of the law. And if you say that some are more equal than the others, it makes problem. The Americans are very pragmatic about that, don't have any problem to discuss about if something exists, we'll study it. So they talk about lobbying and all types of political action, political influence strategies. Many, the literature on these issues is essentially American literature. In Europe, even now, you don't have a lot of things about that. You have ONGs in the United States that observe, scrutinize very, very carefully all kind of actions, and they don't have all the possible information. But you have an ONG, Public Integrity. It's very open. You can, if you, in Internet Public Integrity, you can make a subscription and you receive messages. I'm a receiver of the messages. Well, are more or less interesting, but sometimes you have very interesting information concerning actions, corruption, or gifts, or gray zone actions, which are proposed by this ONG to say, well, what happens in this state?
The issue is protecting, for instance, for instance, there was a guy from Switzerland that gave to the French government a list of people that have, okay, used this Swiss bank just not to pay tax. And now this guy has big problems, very big problems. So it's not exactly the same if this type of warning is covered by law and laws that people not to be then prosecuted or not.
From my point of view, you have to protect guys like that. But you understand very well that you have very powerful interests that are opposed to this kind of legislation. Of course, but everything, if you protect these guys, everything became possible. Secrets, important secrets that are diffused to everybody. So resistances are very, very, very strong to go to this direction. But of course, from my point of view, we have to introduce protection of this kind of action. But, well, political game.
Maybe just a very, very short question, and maybe short answer. How is it possible to study corruption? When you are an economist and you want to work on this issue, how do you do this?
Generally, you have investigations. Anonymous investigations. There are ONGs that make quite interesting work on corruption, generally on the basis of inquiries. Of course, an inquiry has the advantages and the inconveniences of an inquiry. People say what they want to say. Otherwise, study cases, case studies, but it could be a little bit dangerous if you try to go farther indeed. And so we, of course, interests are very powerful indeed. So if I don't, everybody, it's a common secret, it's not a secret, but it's a common knowledge that an enterprise like Siemens, as I said before, in Greece were very involved in corruption practices. Well, nobody has investigated really what exactly was. And they have to find an arrangement. Now Siemens finance some initiatives for entrepreneurship and innovative activities as, let's say, a compensation of what they have done before. But never we have had any real investigation about what was really, what they have done really. It was an arrangement at very high political level. So it's very difficult to make a profound analysis of the practices and so on. So the most common way is inquiries. Inquiries concerning the perceptions of executives, the perception of users, and so on. But every time in this type of, when you ask, for example, a German firm, what do you think about corruption in the countries when you invest? Ah, we lost a lot of contracts because of corruption, but every time, never they will say that we have practiced it also. Okay, so it's, well, it's a bias, but well, it's a way to understand a lot, a little bit.
Okay, thank you very much, Yorgos.
Thank you all.